Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My name is Muhammad Irfan Haziq bin Muhammad Nazarul Zaman and my student ID is 2022908403. Today, we are from AC2204F. We would like to present to you about the segmental reporting and interim reporting of the chosen company, which is Axiata. Before we get any further, let me introduce to you a bit about the company. Axiata was formed on 1992 and before that was known as TMI, which stands for Telecom Malaysia International Berhad. Axiata changed name and logo on 2009 to the new name, which is Axiata, and the new logo, which is this one. Axiata is the largest carrier in the country. Not just that, Axiata is also a leading regional telecommunication which have a strong footprint in spanning of 11 countries, which is Malaysia, Indonesia, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Cambodia, Nepal, Pakistan, Myanmar, Laos, Thailand and Philippines. Axiata also has transformed itself from a holding entity into a triple core strategy business. Axiata has a various business focusing in digital technologies. They have a strong footprint in three business segments, which is digital telcos, digital business and infrastructure. In digital telcos, Axiata have five business, which is Celcom, XL Axiata, Dialog, Robi, Smart and Ncell. In digital business, Axiata have Boost, Aspirasi and ADA. And for infrastructure, Axiata have E.co. Now, I would like to talk about the management approach. There is four factors to be considered in preparing the segmental reporting. The first factor is nature of the business activities. Axiata is engaged in provision of mobile communication and network transmission related to services. It operates through the following segment, which is mobile, infrastructure and others. Axiata also an investment company. They manage and operate telecommunication related to business and provide management consists of consultancy, technical and engineering service. Number two, nature of production process. Axiata process as a telecommunication company that provides digital telco, and the company has controlling interest in mobile operator. For example, Axiata provide Celcom in Malaysia, XL Axiata in Indonesia and Dialog in Sri Lanka. The third factor is type of class of the customer for the product and services. Axiata provide services to those people for all categories of income, such as student, employee, and basically for anyone who own electronic devices will be targeted customer of Axiata. And the last factor is method used to distribute the product or provide the services. Axiata use telecommunication transmitter tower as the method to distribute and provide services for their customers. Now, type of segment. Axiata use a geographical segment in operating of the segment. Axiata primarily provides mobile and infrastructure services and operate in four main geographic, which is Malaysia, Indonesia, Bangladesh and Sri Lanka. Now, I would like to talk about the chief of decision making and its responsibility. Dr. Hans Vijaya Surya was appointed as the CODM of the company on January 2022. He is responsible for overall success of Axiata Group Berhad and for making the top level managerial decision. He also responsible for communicating on behalf of the company with the shareholders, government entities and public final decisions. Dr. Hans Wijaya Surya also responsible for leading the whole development of the company's short-term and long-term strategies and creating and implementing the company's or the organization vision and mission.
Assalamualaikum, my name is Shazwina Zahira Binti Razaifi and I'm going to continue the presentation on segmental report. If a particular product or service of the entity is significant and constitutes as an identifiable business in which the entity operates, then the product or service would be reported as a separate operating segment. For a reporting purpose, a reportable segment is one that meets any of the following quantitative thresholds, which consist of revenue, profit and assets. As for revenue, its reported revenues from sales to external customers and inter-segment sales is 10% or more of the combined revenues of all operating segments. As for profits, the absolute amount of the segment's reported profit or loss is 10% or more of the greater of the combined reported profit of all segments reporting profits or the combined loss of all segments reporting losses. Lastly, for assets, the segment's assets are 10% or more of the total assets of all operating segments. However, not all operating segments need to be separately reported. Operating segments are only required to be reported if they exceed quantitative threshold of more than 10%. If a segment does not meet the 10% criteria, first, it can be designated as a reportable segment despite its size. Second, it can combine with other identical segments that are also below thresholds of significance for the purpose of meeting the 10% test, or lastly, it can be included in all other segments category. Furthermore, after determining the reportable segments, the entity should ensure that the total external revenue attributable to those reportable segments is at least 75% of the entity's total external revenue. When the 75% threshold is not met, additional reportable segments should be identified, even if they do not meet the 10% thresholds, until at least 75% of the entity's total external revenue is included in its reportable segments. Axiata Group Berhad primarily provides mobile services and operates in a total of 6 geographical segments, which are Malaysia, Indonesia, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Nepal, and Cambodia. However, not all operating segments need to be separately reported. Operating segments are only required to be reported if they exceed the 10% quantitative threshold test. For Axiata Group Berhad, we applied the revenue test to identify the reportable segments and non-reportable segments. As a result, there are 4 reportable segments in this company consisting of Malaysia, Indonesia, Bangladesh, and Sri Lanka. The result for the total revenue for Malaysia shows a percentage of 27.21%, 33.86% for Indonesia, 16.41% for Bangladesh, and 10.52% for Sri Lanka, where the reported revenue satisfies the 10% threshold test. Next, the 75% rule is met when the total external revenue attributable to those reportable segments of Malaysia, Indonesia, Bangladesh, and Sri Lanka is 88.49%, which exceeds the 75% rule. Therefore, no additional reportable segments should be identified. Nepal and Cambodia will remain as non-reportable segments and grouped together as all other segments category. If the 10% operating profit test is to be applied to identify the reportable segments and non-reportable segments of Axiata Group Berhad, there will be 4 reportable segments in this company consisting of Malaysia, Indonesia, Nepal, and Cambodia. The result for total revenue for Malaysia shows a percentage of 54.18%, 18.14% for Indonesia, 10.63% for Nepal, and 15.72% for Cambodia, where their percentage of largest of operating profit or loss reported revenue satisfies the 10% threshold test. This is the new segmental report of Axiata Group Berhad, reconstructed after identifying the reportable segments of the company by using the revenue basis, after calculating based on the 10% threshold test and the 75% constraint. The reportable segment of the company that we include here are Malaysia, Indonesia, Bangladesh, and Sri Lanka. Meanwhile, we group the non-reportable segments, which consist of Nepal and Cambodia, as one under all other segments category. In this new segmental report, the total revenue is amounted to 12,268,836 ringgit. To conclude the report, the segment asset of Axiata Group Berhad is 12,410,621 ringgit, and the segment liabilities are amounted to 20,352,706 ringgit. All in all, Axiata Group Berhad uses segmental reporting to document different geographical areas of the business. The company utilizes segmental reporting to better comprehend the nature and financial implications of their business activity, as well as the economic context which they operate. There are several advantages and disadvantages of segment reporting. One of the advantages is to promote transparency by separating profitable and non-profitable segments. Areas that are profitable and areas that drain on the bottom line can be disclosed. Thus, various steps can be taken to maintain the profitability while increasing the profit of other segments. Next is gaining better prediction of profitability. Segment reporting enables financial statement users to have better prediction on organization's future profitability, specifically when it involves in various activities. Lastly, it can reduce cost of capital. The risk of investing in the stock of a firm that reveals all information is theoretically lower than the risk of investing in the stock of a company that withholds information. However, there are also several disadvantages of segment reporting. Firstly, there will be data manipulation, where it leads to misinterpretation by user groups if the segment sales figures are larger than the consolidated sales figures. Besides, another problem arises when determining segment costs. However, the real problem arises in determining share of segment costs out of a common cost incurred on two or more segments. Second is the provision of new data raises the firm's operating costs in terms of management control system expenditures. The cost argument is also linked to the possibility of increasing competition as a result of segment reporting. Third, there will be difficulty in providing data. Measurement problems have created problem of difficulty in providing data while doing segment reporting, since the measurement problem influences the feasibility of disclosing certain information. One should look at the problem of determining segment information. That is all from me. Thank you.
Hi, Assalamualaikum. My name is Nur Nadia Amandi binti Muhammad Jasri with student number 20227.5867. I would like to continue presenting about interim report of Axiata Group Berhad. Interim report is a financial report covering a period of less than 1 year. There are two bases of preparation of the interim report, which consists of first integral, which is the fraction of annual report, and the second is discrete, which treats interim report in a separate period. In Axiata Group Berhad, they prepare quarterly report with a periodic basis of 3 months. The condensed interim financial statement ended 30 June 2022 of the company and the group prepared in accordance Malaysian Financial Reporting Standards MFRS 134 Interim Financial Reporting. Second, International Accounting Standards 34 Interim Financial Reporting under paragraph 9.22 and Appendix 9B of the Bursa Malaysia Securities Berhad. Accounting policies used in Axiata Group Berhad are MFRS 116 Property, Plant and Equipment and MFRS 121 Foreign Exchange. MFRS 116, the company acquired additional PPE mainly for its telecommunication network equipment and capital work in progress. Included in the additional PPE is a universal service provision asset of a subsidiary and acquisition of telecommunication towers by a subsidiary. Meanwhile, MFRS 121, during the current quarter and financial period to date, the group recognized net foreign exchange losses of 475.7 million ringgit, mainly arising from the revaluation of USD borrowings and working capital. Axiata Group Berhad used a discrete method in their interim report, which includes statement of profit or loss and other comprehensive income, statement of financial position, statement of changes in equity, and lastly, statement of cash flows.
Hi, my name is Siti Nur Fatia Eliana binti Shabudin, and my matrix number 2022-782-675. Firstly, is statement of financial position. The current interim report is at 30th June 2022, which is from 1st April 2022 to 30th June 2022, while the comparative is at 31st December 2021, which the period is from 1st January 2021 to 31st December 2021. Next is statement of profit and loss and other comprehensive income. For this statement will be divided into two parts, which is current interim report and cumulative year to date. The current interim report is at 30th June 2022, which is the reporting date is from 1st April 2022 to 30th June 2022. While the reporting period for cumulative year to date is 6 months, which is from 1st January 2022 to 30th June 2022. The comparative for current interim report is at 30th June 2021, which is from 1st April 2021 to 30th June 2021, and the comparative for cumulative year to date is at 30th June 2021. The third statement is statement of changes in equity. The reporting period for cumulative year to date is 6 months, which is from 1st January 2022 to 30th June 2022. And comparative is from 1st January 2021 to 30th June 2021. Last but not least, statement of cash flow. The cumulative period is from 1st January 2022 to 30th June 2022, while comparative period is from 1st January 2021 to 30th June 2021. So, the last part is adjustment. For this question, we decided to make the adjustment for inventories and trade receivable. The first adjustment is about inventories. The cost of inventories as at 30th June 2022 is 208,572,000 ringgit. Meanwhile, the net realizable value of the inventory is 199,385,000 ringgit as at 30th June 2022. The standard stated that the value of inventory should be the lower between cost and net realizable value. Therefore, in this case, the value of inventories that will present in the interim financial report is at net realizable value, which is at 199,385,000 ringgit. The last adjustment is about trade receivable. As at 30th June 2022, there is an increase in the company's allowance of doubtful debt amounted to 322,580,000 ringgit due to the bankruptcy of some debtors affected by the pandemic COVID-19. So, this is the calculation of adjustment of trade receivable. The amount of trade receivable as at 30th June 2022 minus the doubtful debt will be equal to 5.43 million ringgit. The amount of trade receivable will be decreased. Here is the extract statement of financial position as at 30th June 2022 that show the amount before and after adjustment. Inventory and trade receivable is under current asset. The amount of inventories before adjustment is 208,572, while the amount after adjustment is 199,385. Lastly, the amount of trade receivable before adjustment is 5,368,620, while after adjustment is 5,043,022.